He's so sad. I know. Let's get the screen level with the top.
I'm trying to do it though.
Quick announcement here. On your course webpage, the key for problem set one is us. All 17 pages of it. And also I added the art for this one if you want to do it. Mystery to you, please do go through that code. I tried to comment it out for you as well as possible so you can follow along. All right. Any questions from yesterday? I had lots of folks come to the office. I was asking more questions. That was good. Any questions remaining? Everything's perfectly clear, huh? I want to just quickly summarize a little bit of what I talked about or finished up talking about yesterday. This is just the tail end of lecture four, if you don't mind. And I understand that sometimes you guys don't like choices in life, right? I mean, it would be nice if I just said, here are account data. You type in GLM, family, plus Poisson, and you're done. Everybody would love to have that. That's not the way the world works. And to be honest, if the world worked that way, well, I'd be homeless, and you guys would be doing something else with your life. So the key thing is as we go through life, you realize that there are many ways to tackle the problem. You get count data. You get counts of numbers of successes. That does not necessarily mean that it is deriving from a particular distribution. And so therefore, you have to make reasonable choices in life as you're analyzing the data. And so we've talked about, really, there's an infinite number of estimating functions that could be chosen. You can specify, the part that I started with way back into 11 was getting you guys to think about specifying the mean model, something that's derived from the scientific question, that becomes defined, right? That's fixed by what you're trying to answer. But then after that, then the estimation framework comes into play. It's like, now that I have this model written down, how do I estimate the parameters that are in that model based upon a given set of data? And again, what I'm trying to get you guys to realize is there's lots of estimating functions and techniques that can be used there. One of the other estimating techniques that we're going to go to as this course goes along is a Bayes technique as well, right? I've been focusing mostly on frequentists right now. That's another, yet another class of estimating techniques that one can use, okay? And so, my general strategy for something like this is I start off by saying, let me just consider some initial probability model. This is the way that I go about things in life, right? I'll start off with something that I'll consider a quote-unquote reasonable starting point. Then I'll step back for a second, exactly what I'm having you guys do in class. I'll investigate over dispersion. In other words, how off am I to my reasonable starting point? And then I'll come back and I'll apply some sort of a post hoc adjustment in order to say, now that I've conditioned and I've got these estimates, how do I draw inference on the population parameters that I've continued to draw inference on from those estimates, okay? All right. So, again, we've talked about developing the probability model to incorporate over dispersion, and we've also talked about the straight maximum likelihood, okay, as we go through. that was the beta binomial model that I did in this lecture. You guys also did a negative binomial model on your own. Where you can just do the likelihood technique through, say a hierarchical formulation of the problem. But that doesn't necessarily mean that that's guaranteed. That's the way the data actually were generated in reality, right? I mean, that's like it's a made-up paradigm that you could actually mathematically. And so, the one strategy, again, that I take is when I take that initial weighting scheme, the idea here is to try and come, quote-unquote, as close to the true variance as possible. You're doing that for efficiency, okay? But then realizing that if you don't have the exact correct variance, then you gotta fix up the variance estimate at the end of the day. And hopefully you guys have seen by this point that if you've got a large number of samples, quote-unquote clusters as we're going into, you know, this correlated data study, then that robust variance estimator, I view it to some degree as a safety net at the end of the day. Okay? In other words, it makes no assumption about that underlying correlation or covariance structure. So, again, that is the strategy that I employ. I'm not saying that everyone in the world follows that strategy. I wish they would to some degree. To a large degree, actually. But it is the one that I play. It seems to be the most pragmatic to me, yes.
What's robustness?
What's robustness? So when I'm referring to robustness, I mean having assumptions be incorrect and still drawing valid inference, right? That's what I mean by that at the end of the day. So robustness, oftentimes will get used in statistics to think about the robustness of a model to a particular outlier, right? So you might think about the median being robust to outliers, whereas the mean is not, it's influenced heavily by outliers. When I'm talking about robustness in terms of regression modeling strategies like this, I'm really saying I want to be robust to incorrect specification of a model when I make a probabilistic statement. Yes?
How are robust variances measured compared to bootstrapping variance?
Excellent question. So the bootstrap is another way that one could go about this. It is more computationally intensive for sure because it's resampling. We talked about the bootstrap last time. But you can get at, it's an alternative approach. They're not equivalent to one another. The bootstrap is consistent in certain settings. So in other words, if you had linear regression with heteroscedasticity, if you just bootstrapped your observations, not the residuals alone, which is what a lot of people want to do, but that assumes then that the residuals are exchangeable. In other words, they have the same variance. That gets you back to almost scarcity. If you bootstrap your data in terms of observations, then you can come back up with a consistent estimator of the variance. So it is an alternative approach. It's one you can use here. I tend to not advocate it as much because robust variance estimator is computationally cheaper, and they both have basically the same roughly rates of convergence. Go through. In other words, with the bootstrap, you're going to have large sample sizes too in order to gain kind of that variation in the population for the subset. So it's a good question, Norris. That is an approach that folks have used, certainly. And that's probably, you know, the claim to fame for most bootstrap procedures, right, is to say, if I can't write down an analytic form of the variance of my estimator, I'll bootstrap the procedure and get back a variance estimator. Here we're in kind of Huber White's given us a hint of what it is, right? Huber White's given us this idea that it's A inverse B, A inverse. We just don't know B, but we got a moment-based estimator that we can throw in for it. So that's why we can rely upon that in this case. And most, in general cases where people rely upon the bootstrap, they don't have that much information about what's going on. Good. Other questions? Good questions. All right. Then, I've got a couple extra lecture files. If anybody needs one, wants one. Anybody need one?
Back here.
And one of these back. Two of these back.
Okay. Oh, we need a couple more. Do you have a couple more?
Oh.
Oh, you have a question.
Okay.
I thought you wanted.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, so this is like a continuation of the previous one.
Sure.
So maybe we can, in a way, bootstrap only the cheese in this estimator, or would it be reasonable?
No, you could bootstrap the entire procedure here, right? I mean, so in other words, what I could do is I could resample. Let's take the funny example of the Beatles estimator. I'll come back to just bootstrapping Justice Squirrel in one second. But let's take the Beatles example for a second. I could go and resample those jars with replacement. Do that 500 times. Obtain a bootstrap sample, and each one of the bootstrap samples refit my model, get a beta hat, and then take the empirical variance of those beta hats. That would be the bootstrap variance as a beta. So I could do that. It wouldn't work very well because I'm resampling 10 observations with replacement. So I'm not getting a very good idea of what the true population is based upon my pseudo population. Now, Arsene, to go back to your other point, when you're talking about the variance of the score, sure, the score is a random variable, right? So now Arsene is kind of pointless saying, well, let's think about that B that's in the middle there. So he's referring to it as the cheese of our sandwich, right? So we estimated it based upon a Bowman estimator, which was the sum of U transpose and I divide by N, summing across the independent observations. So sure, I could resample my data with replacement. I could estimate that score function. It's a random variable. And I can take one of those empirical estimates and I can take the empirical variance or bootstrap estimate, right? So that would be another way to do it. Again, it's not gonna get you much more than the weak law large numbers though, right? I mean, you know the mean of that guy, or you know the mean of you, it's zero. So you have a great moment-based estimator of what it is. So the performance of them is not going to be differential. And I would actually say, so it would be interesting to look at it in your sample size of 10, you know? So do it under your simulate data where you've got sample size of 10 for the binomial example. And then we'll get it there.